The sixth track on the album, Karma Police, also became the second single to be released from the record. Reaching number 8 in the charts, the single has gone on to become one of Radiohead's most enduring songs.
One of the things that characterizes Karma Police is the chord sequence at the opening, which can't really decide if it's in, as it were, C and A minor or E minor and G, and it's pulling between them. This may well be something that somebody would work out just at the piano, but there are things about this chord sequence which wouldn't make that much sense in terms of classical music, but it works nicely as a sequence itself.
Karma Police is one of those Radiohead songs that expresses that kind of quiet desperation that Radiohead do so well. And obviously, in some ways, it's quite a bitter song. It's almost vengeful. And it is about, I think, justification and seeing things through and overcoming things. But there's a kind of quiet paranoia at work that actually comes through towards the end.
People who do wrong, one day their wrongs will catch up with them. You know, it's the very nature of karma, but there is this task force of people that go around, the karma police, who can suddenly exact revenge or recompense upon these people who've done wrong. This is what you get. This is what you get. This is what you'll get when you mess with us.
This is what happens if you mess with us. Again, very, very sort of sinister. It's almost like, you know, the idea of the army of me, that there is this kind of mass of disaffected people that will somehow or other get their act together. It's a kind of weird mixture of, in some ways, perhaps of like wishful fantasy and hopefully sinister intention.
The kind of chorus, if you like. James Doheny is somebody I've read who spotted that as possibly referring to the track Sexy Sadie on the Beatles' White album.
Sexy Sadie, what have you done?
Standard pop song so far, a little ploddy if anything, and then in the middle of the song it just lifts and you get this beautiful sequence, Tom York in its higher range, this lovely thing, for a minute there I lost myself. And the thing I always liked about it was the word few. He always says that word, few, for a minute there I lost myself.
For a minute, though, I lost myself. I think of explosions in life when we suddenly something comes out of the ordinary, and explosions in art and music that I think Radiohead are very capable of, and they do that, the way that songs break out from this calm. You know, I think of Polanski films and things like that, where things are cut, or Hitchcock, and then suddenly you get this jolt. And I think that Tom York is obviously a very sensitive man. He's very renowned for that. And I, you know, it chimes in with his kind of personality, you know, a line like that.
Fitter, happier. It's interesting how in the sort of sleeves, it's almost, it isn't quite part of the listings. It's almost a kind of adjunct to the rest of the album. And it's a kind of litany of all of the things that you are supposed to do as a kind of well-functioning human being in this particular society.
Fitter, happier, more productive, comfortable, not drinking too much, regular exercise at the gym, 3 days a week.
And also what the song does by listening in that kind of way, in that very, very sardonic way, is to expose their inadequacy. And in terms of, if you actually have any kind of notion in your head of what it might be to live in a radicalized society, then these things aren't the things that will get you there. These are the kind of values that you've got to find a way of dispensing with.
With Fitter, Happier, I think Tom's made it very explicit that he was actually looking at a lot of the kind of self-help manuals that sell in abundant quantities to people who are looking for something that's missing in their life. And I think the way in which he tackled that in basically preparing a wish list was very, very effective.
If you believe there just might be something you can do in the next 10 days that would make your personal life, your family life, and your business life better, can I see your hands, please? How many of you believe the choice is yours? How many of you believe every choice has an end result? There is something I can specifically do that will make my future either better or worse.
If you do all these things, if you tick every box, it's not necessarily going to produce any kind of happiness in your life.
That is a kind of a bitter piece, really, I think, because it's made up of all these phrases, goals, wishes that the ordinary, vaguely successful, vaguely affluent kind of student or 20-something would kind of want out of life. And I think York feels uncomfortable with that. For some reason, it's something that he's almost felt oppressed by, I think, in a way.
Dinners and saturated fats, a patient better driver, a safer car, baby smiling in backseat, sleeping well, no bad dreams, no paranoia, careful to all animals, never washing spiders down a plug hole, keep in contact with old friends, enjoy a drink now and then, will frequently check credit at moral, bank, hole in wall, favors for favors, fond but not in love.
Behind the voice, there's some kind of studio computer sounds going on, and there's the makings of a little tune there. There are just two chords. And just behind it, you can just about hear a track like this, an old film theme. You might be able to hear something like that. It's not a kind of French movie kind of music in the background there. Again, the juxtaposition of these very kind of unemotive words with this just hint of something quite emotional behind it. It's a lovely juxtaposition, and I think.
Fitter, healthier, and more productive, dead, in a cage, on antibiotics.
Electioneering's a strange one. To me, it sounds the oldest of all the songs on OK Computer. It could come from the bends. It doesn't want to sit down with the rest of the songs. It's up. It lifts you back up out of the weirdness of Fitter, Happier, I guess, as well.
Surface, it seems to be a bit of a jibe at the way that politicians conduct themselves. And I'd heard the story that Tom, actually on tour in America, was basically shaking hands and saying, you know, can I guarantee your vote in the forthcoming election, etc. But I think what it actually embodies is his own anxiety about the position that he is in. I think it basically seems to me more powerfully about his compromises as a rock star, as somebody who actually is in the business of selling records and his complete discomfort with that.
despite the fact that the song had been written many months before Tony Blair's new government came into office. For many, the sentiment behind it perfectly sums up the new Labour project and its effect on modern politics.
You know, there's a huge water of cynicism in there, you know, in terms of what's happening with contemporary politics. I think Tom York at that stage was educating himself very well. I mean, he was reading stuff like Hobsbawm's Age of Extremes, the Marxist view of the 20th century. He was reading Will Hutton's The State We're In. Learning, you know, as you should do when you're an artist like that and you're, you know, in the public eye. I mean, he takes his responsibilities quite keenly and carefully, I think, which is good. I think a lot of the trouble with rock, it's just in this, it's in its own little bubble a lot of the time. And what I like about Radiohead and Tom York in particular, that he makes it engage with the real world and contemporary issues. And I think that's one of the crucial things about OK Computer. People didn't quite understand what the concept was, but they knew it was a critique in many ways of a lot that's happening in contemporary society.
In 1997, I think there were an awful lot of people at the time who were infused with this great sense of optimism at Tony Blair coming in, getting rid of the Tories. Quite a lot of people did buy into that idea at the time and, you know, were filled with that things can only get better optimism. But really, in that lyric, Tom York pretty much nails like a Tony Blair. I think that anyone looking back now would see that retrospectively. It wasn't even that a lot of people, the scales fell from their eyes with Tony Blair, but with Tom York, the scales weren't even in his eyes in the first place.
In some ways, you know, climbing up the walls is the most opaque or oblique lyric on the album. It's quite unclear exactly what York is saying with this track. It's certainly one of the more kind of intense sort of passages on the record. Sense of sort of domestic menace, you know, his preoccupation with demons. There is something quite sort of disturbing about this track. And what is it that's climbing up the walls? What is the eye in this track?
Maybe it's from Tom York's individual experience, who knows? It may be something about our darkest nightmares.
Lyrically, it's a bit like songs like Every Breath You Take. There's an element of that in there about the idea of the sheer insidiousness of the song, the insidiousness of the narrator. It's really kind of quite a nasty song.
But it kind of climaxes in the unholy and scary sort of tempest of strings and other treated effects.
The band talked about being influenced by Penderecki. Time in popular music where more and more artists are using orchestras in a very conventional, studied way. And I think what was great about that track was that it actually mixed the influences. So although the violins were there, they were all tuned to different kind of textures, and the time signatures were all messed about.
The arrangement, if you like, is something that's quite in addition to the song. It's not just a kind of emphasizing of a bass line or the chord sequence. It's a real kind of integral part of the track, as it were.